Your best time.
Yeah, my clock is slow.
Can you please rise to the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Dear God, we gather here this morning. We thank you for this beautiful day, for this opportunity to be here to serve our county. And we ask for your presence with these leaders today as they make decisions. Give them your wisdom and help them consider the outcomes of all the things that they do. Thank you again for this, all that we are able to do. We're able to serve one another and help be with the residents of our county as well. Help them to be faithful citizens and to do the things that are their responsibility. We ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Thank you very much.
All right.
Were there any questions on the minutes? Did you guys get to look at the minutes?
Yeah, I looked at them. Okay. I have no questions.
I didn't.
Okay, we'll need a motion.
Make a motion that we approve the minutes as written for September 15th, 2016.
I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All opposed, same sign. Thank you. Nicole, did you have?
Yes, I have a few things I want to discuss. As you know, we had some issues with our DOL inspection. One of those included that we were lacking a lot of county policies that were required by law to have. Some of those policies include having a safety plan for the courthouse in case there was an emergency, tornado, fire, shooting. The other things that we were lacking are countywide policies on bloodborne pathogens, the handling of hazardous chemicals, lockout procedures for working on electrical equipment. I have almost finalized drafts of all of those policies. Yesterday I met with department heads for the fire department, EMS, emergency services, sheriff's office, because we're wanting to draft those policies in a way where departments that deal with these issues day in, day out are able to draft more specific policies without being in violation of the general county policy. I anticipate that by next meeting, we'll be able to adopt all of those by resolution. There were two things I just wanted to make you aware of, though. One, the thing to keep in mind is, one, we're required to have these policies, but part of having these policies, then we're going to have to come in compliance mm-hmm. with those policies. And I'm sure there will be some cost involved. We probably need to look into having eye wash stations at each county facility. Just minor things like that. The other thing is, generally, a county has a safety officer, someone who kind of oversees to make sure that those policies are generally being complied with. The way that I've written these policies is that we would have a safety coordinator, and that safety coordinator, and this is kind of my vision that I wanted to run by you guys to see how you want to handle it. I think it would probably be best at the beginning of the year to appoint a commissioner, the safety coordinator. And so that way that commissioner understands the policies for safety issues. They can know ahead of time if there's going to be any financial issues. They can kind of keep an eye on it. And then what I envision is actually creating a safety committee where the coordinator appoints the department heads. And it's a way to sort of hold those department heads accountable to make sure they're either following the general policy or, if necessary, that they've actually drafted and they're following their own. I don't anticipate, that meeting every month or anything like that. But we do need somebody to sort of have oversight. And I think it makes sense to appoint a commissioner as a safety coordinator. But ultimately, that's going to be your guys' decision on how to handle that situation. I would anticipate, at the beginning of the year, you guys appoint a chair, and usually you identify someone as a financial officer. I would envision appointing the safety coordinator at that point. Ultimately, that's your decision on how you want to handle that. You could always choose an employee to be a safety coordinator. I will say that makes me uncomfortable. I think this is probably one of those roles where a commissioner would better serve that role. So be thinking about that, if that's how you want that to be worded or not. Like I said, by October 15th, I would like to have the policies actually adopted. And then we could appoint a safety coordinator by resolution. And if we want to wait until the first of the year to do that, we could. So just be thinking about how you want to handle that safety coordinator position. Second thing is on the tax sale. I talked to Dolores. We have about $170,000 in back property taxes that would fall within the time frame for this resolution that we're talking about. We do need to place an advertisement to get quotes from an abstractor on them preparing certificates of title. What Dolores and I discussed doing is she is going to go ahead and send out letters to everyone who has back taxes, informing them that we're in the process of obtaining an abstractor, and if they contact her and take care of those before November 30th, then they won't be responsible for paying the additional fee that we would impose after the abstractor does a certificate of title. And I would anticipate that the abstractor would start working on certificates of title December 1. That $170,000 is about 140 properties, just so you guys have a good idea of where we stand on that. So we will need an advertisement asking abstractors for quotes to prepare certificates of title for a tax sale. Email you?
Email.
Yep, we'll do. And then the final thing is, I was thinking a little bit about Brian Murray, the bonus to kind of bump him up for this year to get him past that DOL standard, at least for this part of the year. And I think what you guys can do is, I looked into this a little bit, for this year, if you would make it a policy that if he, I want to make sure I get my exact language right. If he satisfies all the requirements of the work plan pursuant to the grant, he will get a $10,000 bonus this year that is not at the discretion of the board, which is what you guys have done with that money in the past. If he satisfied all the work plan areas for all the work plan performance plan for all three counties, he got the $10,000. I think if you word it that way, it makes it non-discretionary. And for this year, at least, you pay that bonus. It's a $10,000 non-discretionary bonus, and it counts towards his salary.
So the bonus would come out of the grant?
Right. So the way that's worked, I think, the last 3 years, is that's the kind of grant that you guys, you get the money towards this time of the year, and then it has to be expensed before the end of the year. And the problem with it has always been you can't supplant the budget with it. So anything that has been budgeted, you can't pay. In the last few years, that $10,000 has always gone to Ryan as a bonus.
Okay. I'm in a meeting with Brian. Ryan. Earlier this week.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this year, they changed some of the criteria on that award.
I think you're talking about a different grant, because did you guys have a discussion about, because I know there's a payroll gap in emergency services right now, because we're going to get two payouts for two different grants at the end of the year. Because we're going to get one that's the $10,000 that in the past you guys have given to him as a bonus, and there's me a second payout. And I know Ryan and I had talked about the fact that there is a, because some raises were given in that department, that weren't budgeted for this year, and for the second grant that comes in, since those weren't budgeted, he was going to cover payroll from the second grant that come in to make sure that emergency management came in under budget for their department.
So the EMC grant has a personal performance portion of it,
mm-hmm.
which in the past they have given that to him. I think it was $7,128 or $82, something like that. I don't see a problem on that.
And, I mean, it's what you guys have been doing the last few years. And I think if you just say today that under that grant, if he satisfies the work plan performance to provide the services to the three counties, he will receive a non-discretionary bonus under that grant from this board. And that way, you guys don't have discretion at that point.
Yeah.
If he satisfies those requirements and the money comes in, and I would say just do it for this year. And then, you know, next year, you know, you can start looking at, because I believe next year you guys bumped him up enough that he's beyond the DOL requirement to be exempt.
I don't remember. Yeah.
Which you guys will need to look at, but that would be my advice for this year is, and I mean, I would request that you guys, if you want to do that, and here's the benefit of that, then he's an exempt employee, he's over that requirement, and you don't have to worry about paying him overtime.
Yeah.
Which, for that position, is significant. Because that, you know, one of the things about overtime is it has to be necessary, and that's always a concern when you're dealing with emergency management services is, you know, that necessary analysis is going to be a little different. So if that's something you guys want to do, what I'd ask you to do is to make a motion today to say if Ryan Murray meets the work plan to serve all three counties under the grant, that he will receive a non-discretionary bonus based on the final payout of that grant.
Because we don't know what the final payout is yet. Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, I got no problem with that.
Okay. You want to make the motion then?
Do I have to repeat what our attorney just said?
Well, it's just under the grant if he satisfies.
Okay. I make a motion that the that a payout be made to Ryan Murray.
As a bonus.
As a bonus. as determined by the final criteria?
Here's what I would say. If Ryan satisfies the performance plan of the grant,
okay.
Then if Ryan satisfies the performance plan of the grant, the board will grant him a non-discretionary bonus based on the final payout of the grant.
Okay. If Ryan Murray satisfies the
performance plan under the grant the board will grant him a non-discretionary bonus
as determined by the final payment.
Do I hear a second? I second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Okay.
We got it.
Yeah.
You're going to have Star Wars just a little short. Forever.
The memory span went.
Okay. Nicole, did you have anything else for now?
That's all for now. Okay. Thank you.
The Fair Board.
I do got one question.
Okay, sorry.
These Department of Labor standards that you talked about with the safety thing, is that going to be put in the employee handbook?
No, those will be different. So,
okay.
And I will, we have pretty final drafts of everything. I'll go ahead and email those out to you. But since these aren't actually, I would say these are separate safety policies. I mean, The reality of it is, by the end of 2017, our county is probably going to go from having one employee policy handbook to having almost a dozen different policies.
Yeah.
Which, legally, a lot of these things we're required to have, and we just have not had. The other good thing about that is, in meeting with some of the department heads, most of our departments are in compliance within their small department, mm-hmm. Both DOL and other regulatory requirements for a lot of safety issues. We are going to need to work with the fire department. I met with Dan Blair on that, and he's very open to sitting down and writing up some very formal policies, which we really need for the fire department. But that may, mm-hmm. I think that's probably going to be the most work. It's something that I'm going to help Dan with, but whoever the safety coordinator is going to be is also going to have to work with a little bit. So, and if you guys have a different idea on who to have the safety coordinator be, you know, think about it and bring up the next meeting. I thought long and hard yesterday about it, and I really think that probably makes the most fit, because ultimately you guys are their supervisors. I think, you know, I had considered putting it with the clerk's office, but this is beyond human resources to me. I mean, this is actual liability issues, regulatory compliance, and I think it makes more sense to have someone in a true supervisory role. And my vision of that is that the coordinator is not going to be the one actually making those decisions. It's going to be more of a person who knows what the policies are and then delegates to make sure department heads are taking care of whatever safety issues they have within their department.
Okay, our current camp liability insurance has provisions in there for safety instructions. Mm-hmm. And if we follow those guidelines, there are reductions, or I guess you'd call it reductions, made in the policy by complying with those requirements. Have you had a chance to ever look at that?
Yeah, and that's actually something that's actually going into our courtroom safety plan as well, to try to adopt all those. I would envision, here's what I envision. We adopt these policies, work with them for a year, you know, have the safety coordinator, have at least the safety committee meet twice, and then we'll probably go back with, after that first year, change those policies. Mm-hmm. And I would envision at that point, once we've kind of figured things out, we will be in full compliance with K-Camp requirements and DOL. And not only will we save a little bit of money, but I think liability-wise, we'll be at a very good place.
Very good basis. Good.
Which we have some issues there that need to be addressed. But I think this time next year, I think we could be at a really good place with our safety policies. So just give that a thought. The more I think about it, I like the idea of having the safety coordinator be the commissioner, but ultimately that's your guys' decision.
Okay.
That's all I have.
Well, thank you, Nicole. I did have a text from Dan last night that he wanted me to share. It says, I cannot give you an answer on the fire marshal thing until I know the job description and an idea of how much time it will take. Is it full time or just part time thing, or any of that? Would you mind passing that info on? And so, and he also wants to talk to Lauren about that. So,
this is in regards to appointing him as fire marshal,
yes,
county,
yes, exactly.
Fire marshal.
Yeah.
I don't blame him. I would want a job description.
Exactly.
And it would be up to us to try to determine how much time it might take for him to do that.
So we need to look into that.
Kind of what I was thinking about was we need somebody to coordinate training for both fire departments that have needs for training for rural fire.
Well, and the other thing that, and I was going to talk to Deb and you guys about this, for all department heads, including that position, I mean, we need to make sure included in their job description is a requirement to make sure that their department complies with all county safety policies and that they comply with their own regulatory compliance of written policies,
mm-hmm.
which I will tell you, for the fire department for next year, is going to be a lot of work. a lot of work.
Well, we need to be able to have an answer for him.
So not only coordinating that, but one person to gather the material for a budget. You recall the time it took to try to iron out who needed what on the fire needs last July. So we need one person to gather that up and present the data to the board. So those are two areas, key areas, that could be time consuming.
One other thing with the fire department, Dan brought in a bill yesterday for the training manuals, the class that the board approved. Dan Blair and Kevin Tremley are going to Goodland. Those are the two fire department people. He asked me a question, and I said that would probably be a board decision, but he wanted to know if either he or Kevin were hurt during this training, whose work comp would they fall under? Would it be the city's or the county's? And
we're splitting the bill for the training, 50-50.
I didn't have an answer to that.
So who would be primary, who would be secondary as far as insurance goes?
To be honest, I don't think there's a clear answer on that. If it happened, there would be some legal contention between the two parties about whose comp picked that up.
He's on his own.
I mean,
just don't get hurt.
There would be a... I don't have an answer.
No, I really can't right now, unless we did a formal agreement to resolve that.
Mm-hmm. The classes have started, and the commitment has already been made, and they are going. So, you know, I
mean, they will be covered comp-wise, but my guess is it would actually probably be like a 50-50 split between the two. But if that happens, I guarantee there will be a little bit of a legal fight between the county and the city about how that split happens. More the insurance companies, I guess. But so there is no clear answer on that.
Oh, boy. All right. Yep. We did the Fair Board loan.
They made a payment, but I think we ought to, out of this year's funds, we ought to pay the remainder of that. How do you two guys feel?
How much is left?
Huh?
How much is left?
I was told it, but I can't remember. Deb, do you happen to have that figure?
I would have to go back in the minutes and look. It seems like they made about a $4,000 payment, and I think there was maybe a $7,000 balance.
Seven's what I thought.
So three or $4,000, roughly.
Let's find out, and we'll make a decision at the next meeting.
Okay. Dale, did you have anything?
No. I was just thinking that sounds about right.
Roughly.
Okay, these... KSA 132 exercise design course.
Yes. Cheryl Slover was not able to be here today, and she wanted approval to go to, it's a HSEEP meeting November 8th through the 10th in Topeka. She needs approval to spend up to $600 in travel expense for meals and mileage for her to attend this class. It says Kansas Exercise Design Course for Discussion-Based Exercise in Topeka. They don't offer this class in another location, and Ryan does have the funding in his budget if he's approved.
Can I see that for a minute, and I'll make a motion on it?
That was just the email that she had sent me.
I think you got to add it too.
Yeah, I forwarded that on to each one of the board members, and then that was my copy for.
And I don't have a problem
to make
it.
Sure.
I don't either. I'll make a motion that we approve Carol Soper attending the Kansas Exercise Design Course for discussion-based exercises in Topeka on November 7th, 2016. in the amount of $600 for travel expenses.
I'll second.
Okay, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Okay. The resolution 16 through 21 were ones we're going to wait.
Yes.
Okay. Because that was the ones that Nicole was talking about, right?
Right. Okay. Right. We're not going to do those this time. But I do have a resolution. The federal people were here this last week, and the big storm that we had back on September the 3rd, Cheyenne County does qualify for federal grants. And so Ryan asked that this resolution, and I think I included that in your packets as well, so that you could read through that and had a chance to discuss it before you signed it. In order to move forward, a resolution now needs to be adopted by the board.
Are you aware of this?
I haven't seen that. I talked to Ryan about it, but...
Yes, I read it last night.
That would be resolution 1616, okay. If so adopted.
16 what? 16.
1616 would be the next number on the resolutions. We're going to disregard those Department of Labor resolutions. I have them written up ready for the meeting, and I have them in the agenda. But then we weren't quite at that point, so I took them out.
Our agenda says resolution 16-21.
That was Nicole's having us wait on those. This is the one.
Nicole had asked me to write resolutions for those Department of Labor policies. I did that. I had them all ready to go. I had the agendas all printed. Yesterday afternoon, after everything was set up, she emailed me and said, no, we're not going to do these today. And instead of redoing everything, I'll just renumber those when the board is ready to adopt those. So proclamation for disaster is actually 1616.
1616. Yes. Okay. So we don't have to do anything right now on this?
We need to make a motion.
You need to make a motion. Okay. Motion.
All right. I'll make a motion that we accept a proclamation of a state of local disaster emergency for Cheyenne County for the third day of September 2016.
Resolution number, whatever.
Oh, resolution 16-16.
I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Okay, is Kid Camp questionnaire?
Yes. Each year, I have to fill out a K-Camp questionnaire.
Should I just sign beside him on the slide?
It needs to be presented to the board.
Chair, okay.
Oh, yeah.
It was in your book.
Yeah, there it is.
Yeah, that
one. Yeah, go sign there. It says chairman right there.
Yeah.
There's an extra line there.
I don't know.
I put it on top.
I think you're fine.
I just signed above chair.
Right here?
So sorry.
Right there?
I think
right.
That's fine.
I just said things in a different order.
He took this out of a book, so I can understand why they're
here.
It's just basic information as to does the county have this, does the county have that, but you need to be aware. With your approval, I will submit that to K-Camp today.
Have you guys had a chance to look through the K-Camp stuff? Okay, let's move on to Jeff. Come on up, Jeff.
Good morning, everybody. Morning. There's not a whole lot new. I don't know if any action's been taken on the seal coating, but I think it's still up in the air about the roadways around the village. They're all city, some county, or what?
Thank you. I talked to JR.
That's better. So I requested the city to take a look at the access road to the airport that runs past the village, and we kind of determined to put in a stop sign there because cars go whizzing past, and also to paint a pedestrian crosswalk there from the building across that access roadway to the parking lot. Well, so the city's supposed to be taking care of that one.
Okay.
As for August, the nursing home, our revenue exceeded expenses. The reason for that was because the May payment showed up in August that the county had made to reconcile the first half of the year. And the census is up just a tick in August, 24.5. At the moment, it's 26. So that's going in the right direction. And the accrued Medicaid receivables is a new line that I added. This has to do with residents that have applied for Medicaid. They've been Medicaid pending. And the whole decision system, you know, is broken down. It transferred from KDADS to KDHE. And I was just at a leading age conference this week, and the director of KDHE was there assuring us all that it'll all be straightened out by the end of September. But we have two residents that are Medicaid pending for many months, and so there's $81,580 sitting there that if they were approved for Medicaid, that money should be paid. But of course, Medicaid only goes back about 3 months, not more. And one of these is about a year back and forth. And the family's been working with lawyer in Hayes, Clinksdales. That works with seniors and these kinds of problems. Still, it's not settled. And so that's not a figure that's new for the month. That's cumulative, like through the year, the $81,580.
So how would that affect the bottom line? Would you subtract that from the $115,000?
If you get it.
If we get it, yeah.
If we get it. Okay.
One of the larger facilities reported that they had $300,000 in accrued Medicaid receivables sitting out there, and the state settled and they received $67,000. So it's
out of hand.
It's hitting everybody pretty hard.
Okay.
And then with the senior apartments, they've been running steady at 10. In the block of apartments that was scheduled to be demolished for the assisted living, which isn't a sure thing yet, but one of those residents is going into assisted living, and she'll be going to Goodland assisted living. And another one has found another place to live because she didn't know how long she'd be able to stay in her apartment, even though she likes living there. And so she'll be moving out at the end of the month, this weekend. So that'll bring us down. And meanwhile, there's another new tenant going into apartment one. So then we'll be running at 9 to the end of October. And on the staffing side, we thought we had all the nurses we needed. We had recruited a nurse from Ray, who was going to move here with her family. We thought they had their house sold in Ray, and that fell through. So they have children, so the children are in Ray, and they have special needs. So she's not able to sort of work here and live there. So she's had to backtrack and say, sorry, but it's not going to work out right now. So that means we'll still be using agency personnel to cover open shifts.
Did you have some bids you wanted to show us?
There's nothing new on the seal coating. There should be three. Okay. There were two from earlier and one last time I was here. Should have been submitted. No, not since.
Okay.
I haven't heard from McCormick. I mean, keep in silence.
I'm glad to see a positive number instead of a negative number.
Yeah. Are there any comments or questions? Okay.
Gentlemen? Rodney?
No.
Okay. Good, thanks.
All right. Thanks, everybody.
Okay, thank you, Jeff.
Come on up, Matt.
I just wanted to update you guys. We got word on that grant we were working on for the courtroom recording system. It was denied. So I'm working with Always Sound to try to get them to come up and maybe just make some adjustments that will get us by. But the biggest thing with them is they're out of Topeka, I think, and so cost to get them here will be outrageous, but I don't really have much choice. So they're going to give me an estimate of travel time, mileage, maybe what they think it might take to make some adjustments, and then I'll come back and visit with you guys then.
Okay.
Okay.
So, anyway, biggest news is the grant was denied.
So I was so hopeful.
I know, me too. So, anyway, I'll be back when I get some more information.
Okay, well, thank you for letting us know that.
You're welcome.
Have a good weekend.
You too. Thanks.
All right. Okay, the K-Camp, you want us to look through?
Yeah.
I think Ed had a question on the warrants.
Okay.
Yes, I did. Okay. Gotta find this.
Necessary, isn't it? Just kind of basic operational questions.
Right. Yes. You know what our expenditures are from last year to this year, how many employees we have full-time, part-time, how many employees are ambulance, full-time, part-time, volunteer, fire, same thing. Just basic, what does the county have?
No watercrafts, no.
The one thing I did add, this was new. I just saw you turn the page. Obviously, this is a preparation of next year. So, last year, this was no on the transportation, public transportation. I did say yes this year, and I put that it would be operational in 2016, November. That was changed from last year.
Okay.
The number of employees, up one or two.
Yeah, that's true.
Okay. Just wasn't sure if that was something new that I had seen.
So, I just, and the last thing is on there.
Well, I knew Jeff was coming to that.
Seen it,
I didn't know
so,
there'd be any questions.
Right.
So
gotcha.
Why not have it?
Yeah.
I'll see handbook.
It's an electronic form.
Do you have a motion on it or just an initial?
I think just so noted that you've seen it and approve of him submitting it to Kim. Work comp side of it has already been submitted. That comes directly out of payroll. I run a report. The comp comes in. Everything as far as payroll.
This is what I had a question on. 304-26-29.
There's two of them right there together.
Oh, and Amazon as well, both of these.
Was it the saltwater taffy that you were?
Yeah, and the
well,
one.
Well, that's right next to one another.
And the one above it is
one. One just says taffy, the other one says saltwater taffy.
Yeah.
It was ordered from Amazon, off of Amazon, and it says, where did I go? A 5 pound bag, five pound bags of saltwater taffy. And the other one should be right behind it. That's nosebleed dressing.
Well, I want to know, why should we be paying for that?
Saltwater taffy. This one's for $74.48, and this one's $93.10.
Unless this is what they throw out at the parades, I don't know.
It was a purchase.
A purchase.
When was it?
August 2nd. Well, it was shipped on August the 2nd.
So it may have been for the parades.
Yeah. Order was placed okay. August the 2nd.
That's
yeah.
fine. Now.
Okay.
As long as they can justify
we need to, it. We need to.
Yes, please, that. If you would initial that you've reviewed it.
This one here too, right?
Yes. Good man. Okay. That's the voucher that covers all of it. So, okay, was there any others?
Did you have any questions?
No.
Okay. We need a motion to approve the warrants.
Make a motion that we approve the accounts payable payment register for September 30th.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, same sign. Okay.
And what about payroll?
Oh, and payroll. Were there any questions on payroll, guys?
I had a question on interpretation. I believe you indicated that we're still under the old policy handbook.
Yes.
Overtime has to be approved by a department head or the Board of Commissioners for emergency. Is that correct?
I believe it's if necessary and emergency, something to that effect. And then it's approved by the department head.
It's a and or department head or board of commission.
Okay. I wasn't sure on this old handbook just how that was, the interpretation was on that. I have no other questions.
We'll need a motion to approve that. Do I hear a second on approving the payroll?
I'll second that.
Okay, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Okay. And the K-CAM, you just wanted us to look at it. So.
Right.
Okay. And I'm fine
with
that.
Okay.
And you fine with that? Okay. And Rodney, you were able to look through the K-CAM questionnaire?
Yeah, I looked at that last night.
Okay.
Okay.
Now, the EMS lease agreement?
Yes, that's what I've been working on with the city. If I put a copy in your packet or not.
I didn't see it.
It's the same lease agreement that we've signed last year.
I don't think you signed anything on that.
The only thing, I went in and changed the dates. It was supposed to be done in May, but it just was one of those things that never got done. And so... This at their city council meeting, they thought it was fine, so I went in and just updated the dates in there. So probably in April.
This
we
year's
start
stuff.
Thinking about it next year because we're a little behind this year.
Probably.
Okay.
You can help yourself.
No.
Lila said that the city was okay with it, and I said I will get it typed up and
so nothing's changed except
no, the rates, nothing changed in the rates of what we pay. I had given the city financial reports on expenses and revenues, and they looked at those and they felt like the fund was operating okay. And we didn't need to increase anything. So the amounts are the same. The only thing are the dates.
$950,000.
And that was in the original contract last year. I just updated like 2015 to 16 and 16 to 17. And that's the only thing that changed.
Can you see this?
Yeah, right here. Well, I need to make a motion on that and we approve it, don't I?
Yes.
Okay, I'll make a motion that we accept a mutual cooperation and lease agreement between the City of St. Francis and Cheyenne County for the Emergency Services Building.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign.
You have a copy of this in your package.
It's going to be a bad deal.
This came to me by email.
And it just continues to get worse. You know, the state of Kansas did away with the Department of Aging and transferred it over to the Kansas Department of Health and Environment. They transferred it over. They privatized
it. I can't wait.
And every time
did you see this? No, I did not. I've seen a bunch of little funds this year.
Yeah?
I didn't know we had to damn many of that.
Skilled nursing.
You know that one year I trapped nine? And that last one, I got even a foothold. And I shot, and I shot, and I shot. And I'll never kill another fox. I did kill one 2 years ago, but he got caught up in that foothold. Like four in a row. It was
kind of sad because
I mean, federal when I got there on the podcast,
10%
for
collecting it, and then they distribute to the states based on population.
Well, I don't know who it was. Anyways, on Facebook, big old mountain lion.
Yeah. Well, I've seen one down here on our property. I saw one time there, and I got my first bobcat I ever got like 8 years ago or so on Christmas Day. And the following Monday, I was checking my traps, pulled out on that. It was an ice storm, and I saw him lope across the road, an unforgettable lope with a tail. I hit, put my four-wheel drive on it. Got up there, and the deer were in a perfect circle. There was a buck and buck. And you're talking a week after deer season. They didn't care that I was there with a gun. Anyway.
You didn't hear anything.
Yeah, well, anyway, I went and I checked in my bobcat that morning. I told Mike Hopper, I said, what I saw. I said, he goes, that was a bobcat. I said, Mike, this thing had a tail about this long. And it crossed the road less than a quarter mile in front of me. And I told him, I said, how the deer were. And he said to me, he said, nah, it's a bobcat. I said, so I can shoot it. Come on up, Dave. And he goes, that's when he changed his tone and said, no, if you shoot it, you're in trouble.
All right. How are you today?
Good.
good. You guys?
Pretty good.
Well, it depends on what you're going to tell us.
Tell you nothing but good words, isn't that right?
Then we're fine. Thank you. To finish up that story, though.
Yeah.
Marvin Miller brought me an article in the paper that spring that they'd had one that they tracked up from the Yellowstone clear down our river bottom.
I saw one.
Yeah.
Down along the in between Hale.
Yeah.
State line on the river.
That's the third one I've seen.
Yeah.
Hi, Alicia. Hey, Brad. Mm-hmm. All right. I'm sorry.
On the second page, you'll see we made a payment on that Priestess concrete. This is that section on what we call the Barnhart Bridge.
Mm-hmm.
So, and down on special road improvements, Pinco Engineering, this was to do all the inspections on the asphalt. And then this reimbursed from KDOT Project 12C4721. This is reimbursement from what we was calling the Slept Bridge, Nodal Slept Bridge. It was that 90-10 money, so. Okay. Work done, blade mowing, repairing a lot of washouts, especially up north. The second week, we replaced that 6-foot by 45-foot culvert on Road 19 and the AA.5. It was just wrinkled enough, we didn't. After that storm went through there, that we wound up replacing the old one. So, still working on washouts. The fourth week we went in and things really went well. We drilled through on that old pre-stress section. Lifter come up, took them longer to get set up than it did to do the job, but takes time they get their counterweights and everything loaded on their crane. And picked the old one out, set the new one in, got it welded, didn't match quite as well as I liked, but it had less crown than our old one. But anyway, we got it all welded back together. Things are looking good there. FEMA was whatever, Kansas Department of Emergency Management guys was out Monday, and then this afternoon the FEMA guys are going to be out and look at some of our trouble areas, so that's where we're at with that.
So has that bridge been reopened?
Yes. We opened it up Wednesday morning. So. And the Hensley truck was running that day.
Imagine that.
Okay, I just got off the phone with this Carl Wideman with K-Work. And these was, I think commissioners need to initial, I assume what the chairman is, but Shelley had two violations on hers there at the courthouse. And then the floor hoist that we have up the shop, he said it's a light duty, so it's not required to have a certified inspector, but we need to start doing in-house inspections on it.
What you actually need is a new one.
A new shop, you said?
No, just us. But yeah, the shop. You could probably save enough and eat bill to pay for a building.
So, yeah, we're still looking at it.
But you got a budget for it.
Working on that, yep. So anyway, yeah, if you sign that one, I think that's all we needed for this.
Yeah, okay. I can scan it and send it back to them and then keep it in our files.
You want this cover letter with that too?
Yeah.
Okay.
But it does need to be. or noted that we presented and it was taken care of the safety issue. Yep.
October 13th, we got our highway officials and county commissioner meeting in Sharon Springs. You guys planned on going to it?
I don't, not this year.
What's that?
When was it?
October 13th.
It's a Thursday.
That was the information I presented a meeting or two ago about registration.
I doubt it. I'm sure we'll try to be busy.
I mean, it's sporting events.
What's that?
So when do you have to know?
Today.
Okay. If I got a guess, I'd say no.
Can I invite the two prospective commissioners, whatever, coming up? So, because rightfully, you're president coming up this year. And we host this meeting next year.
Right.
In the fall. All right, I'll let them know on that. I'll see what happens here. Yeah, I don't know that I need a copy of that. Yeah, I probably should anyway. I was approached on this Swindland Pool project. They're going to have about 3,000 yards of dirt and wanted to know if we would haul it down by the old Swindland Pool. So eventually when they take that one out, they'd have dirt to cover it back up.
Three thousand yards. Oh, they said 13,000.
I'm sorry.
So that's going to be
3,000 yards. I figured it was a community project. We'd probably do that, but
yeah.
I wanted to run it by you guys.
Well, if that's all the further you're going, that ain't very far.
Yeah. Is the city going to pay for the diesel, or how do you normally work that? Do we just do it as a service for either of the cities?
That's your guys' call, but I figured with service, but when we get ready to close the other, it may be the all-city problem, so.
I don't have a problem with it.
I don't have a problem with it.
I mean, they're going 3 blocks. How much diesel fuel are they going to use? I mean, that's only like 15 yards or 15 truckloads to go 3 blocks.
No, it's 5 per 100.
20-yard trucks. 3,000.
So,
quite a few yards.
5 times 30. 150.
Nah, still ain't very many.
Okay.
Not I'll going that
a day's run, be my guess. Yeah.
Do we need a motion for that?
I don't think we do.
I don't think so.
The fuel's going to be less than 500.
Okay. Let's go.
Yeah, let's go.
All right.
Thanks, Dave.
That's all I got.
All right, thanks.
Are you happy now?
Oh, I'm always happy.
You seem happy, too.
Come on up, Felicia. It's too late, Brian.
Morning. Good morning. How's everyone this morning?
Pretty good. You?
Good. Beautiful morning.
How are you?
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
One thing that I bought that I wanted to show is that, remember we had the discussion regarding last month when I was here regarding an agent and a representative? Okay, I took this from the state of Kansas book on the difference between a captive agent or an agent, a rep from a carrier, and an independent agent, what I am. So I brought this for you.
And of course,
I brought one.
Not changes too much. I went home and looked it up in Webster's Dictionary, and it says it's the same thing.
But an agent can be a travel agent. It can be any kind of an agent.
Well,
agent,
exactly. But I mean, you did not specify.
Okay, Commissioner Gardner. Oh, I'm sorry.
I mean, I do realize there's a difference, but
yes.
If it's clarified here, I'm going to keep
Gardner. I mean, I went home, I drove back to Smith Center, and I pulled up that day the
thanks,
and there's one. There you go, Carol. anyway, I just wanted you, the top part is when I said that an agent that works for a company, that they get paid from the company and everything, we're an independent agent like all of us are. We work for the client we represent, and you guys get to change and what happens. Anyway, you can tuck that in for boring late night reading. I thought, I'm going to show Commissioner Gardner what. I thought about you.
You didn't say it that damn kind.
Commissioner Gardner, I was very nice. I said, you know that little stubborn guy? No, I didn't.
I'll bet you wasn't even that kind. But
yes, I'm not a mean person. What I've done is Julie has put together, again, a very nice spreadsheet. Because remember when I was here, I said what we were going to do is we were going to collect all the data so you guys aren't looking through all these different proposals and spending a whole day trying to review apples to apples on proposals. So Julia's put this together, and basically just remember when we say throw away money, or when Julie says throw away money, that is money that, remember that pie chart, I'd say, okay, every insurance company, for every dollar comes in, they allocate so much for administration, so much for overhead, and so much for claims. If you don't use that claim money, they keep it. They don't give it back to you. So that's what's considered throwaway money. Okay. So, and Brian's here. I'm so excited because he was able to come over today. So, anyway, I will keep quiet and let you guys listen to what Julie says.
Okay. Well, as Alicia said on bringing all the data together, now with your being a January 1 renewal and this just being the end of September, a lot of the carriers or even the renewal, we should get any day. So these are illustrative numbers, and we'll go through the percent here on the dates on here and when we're going to be able to get firm numbers for January 1. With United Healthcare, of course, we have...
Let me just add one thing. When she says illustrative numbers, normally you have maybe a 2% one way or the other, lower or higher. We always hope for a lower, so it really shows you a percentage here with United Healthcare or with Blue Cross or with Aetna, not NGIC, but those carriers, those could fluctuate a couple of points up or down. And she talked to the head underwriter for United Healthcare. He says it looks like it's running true, but there could be a 2%, because illustrative just means this is what they're, isn't it? Okay, I'll be quiet, I promise.
Yeah, that's so looking at what your current, and this is based on your estimated monthly premium, estimated annual premium are based on 12 singles, 9 employee and spouses, 3 employee and children, and 15 families. So coming in with a high deductible, looking at what you're currently paying on a monthly basis and an annualized basis, and then looking at the renewal with United Healthcare. Again, we have up here 12/1/16, but the underwriter has indicated we ran this as if it was a new group. It's 12.72%, and they said, as Alicia said, give or take 2%, so it could come in a couple points less. But it should be right around that 11-13% on the renewal. With Aetna, the most current rate that we could get on them was a 12.15. Aetna is the one that has purchased Coventry. They come in at 25.47% above current. Now, this NGIC, we go out there, they do require health statements, so that's why it's 33.82% under. I call those pie-in-the-sky numbers. I did illustrate those just to show that we did go submit everything to them also. But again, they require health statements. So
every employee would have to fill out the 2 or 3 pages of health questions, and then they would analyze that and come back in. And we found that most of the time they're with health. If you have a real healthy group, sometimes it's worth it. But and we know some of the issues going on, and it probably won't stick. So, go ahead. I'm sorry.
And then, of course, with Blue Cross and Blue Shield, they're not able to get the January rates as of yet. So I did request from Carol Roadhouse, the new representative with Blue Cross, what the rates would be if it was a 12-1. I did, from the email when I received these numbers, that it says, why we're expecting KID approval very soon, the Kansas of Insurance Department approval very soon. I cannot guarantee that we have the approval prior to the meeting on the 30th. So they went ahead and ran us the 12-1 rates, and we're hoping that they'll have theirs mid-October based on past experience, but could be much later if the process with the Kansas Insurance Department requires additional time. So I went ahead and wanted to show those rates with a 12-1 effective date.
So those are the 19.35%
above current.
So currently, if you compare them, the United Healthcare is several percentages below. Even if you did a couple of points leeway on the Blue Cross, mm-hmm. you'd have anywhere between a 17 or a 21% increase on Blue Cross, and you'd have 10 to 13 on that. So it is better to, the United Healthcare is cheaper for the county.
So the next page I want to go, is there any questions on the rates there? Okay. The next page I wanted to show what we had projected last year. Now remember, the numbers that we looked at were for the high deductible health plan. So, and how we have the plan set up is, as an employer, you're paying the high deductible, and then you put into reserves to pay the claims underneath for the employees.
But so, it's not a pooled, and it's not self-funded.
Correct.
That's where we got into last month about the difference between self-funded is you have maybe a $30,000 stop loss for every employee where the county would be responsible. That is a self-funded plan. A pooled plan is like there was a gentleman that had called. He's an agent in Kansas, and he called me and asked me if the county was interested in looking at a pooled fund, and that's where they have a board of directors, and they sit around and decide in this pool where everyone is, not just the client, but everything goes into it, and at any time, they can increase those premiums at any time. So they look at this pool on a monthly basis, and if they think the pool is not doing as well, they would send and say, we need to collect more money. So I wrote back, I got approval, I wrote back to this agent and said, the county is not interested in self-funded or pooled products. They want to go because you're not on a pooled product. You're not on a self-funded product. So anyway, I'm interrupting again.
No, that's okay. So looking at the employee's plan, and there's where that the plan underneath is designable, that you've been able to, when we took you from corporate plan, we took you from a two-tier plan, a two different plans to one, to where the employees have a $1,000 deductible. After the deductible, it covers 80% to $1,500 out-of-pocket, so not counting your office visit copays and prescription copays. In network, the employees have $2,500 out-of-pocket. They have a $25 office visit copay for a primary care physician, a $50 copay for the specialist, and on your prescriptions, you have $10 for generic, $35 for formulary, and $60 for a non-formulary. That's the benefits that you've given back to the employee. And I can say the benefits that the employees have here with the out-of-pocket and the copays is a very, when you're paying the premium, is a very nice plan. We have a lot of employers that are having to require an employee contribution or increasing that deductible, the out-of-pocket, even more. So looking at your actual cost through August 31st, with today being the end of September, we wasn't able to bring in all the data from September. The actual through August 31st, you're running 6.75% above what we projected. But if you add back in the money that we currently have in reserves,
your little pot of money, okay,
you're running 0.7% above what was projected. So
a year ago, what was projected that you would be running is within 0.7% of being spot on. I still think she should be a bookie. I said, if you could guesstimate a year from now and be within 0.7%. Oh, well.
How do you know what she might like?
I won't tell you what I do on my second job.
No, pay attention.
And I wanted to look at, to show you, to kind of put everything in perspective on, if you would just go out to the market and buy a traditional plan with a $1,000 deductible for the employees, and it'd be all throwaway money. And like Alicia explained before in that pie, there's a portion over here that if you have a very good year, or even if you have met your maximum liability, I mean, you're going to pay and it's all throwaway money. So if you went out with United Healthcare and bought their $1,000 deductible plan, and again, this is a cookie cutter plan. So these plans, you have to go with what their benefits are. You do not have the fluctuation, the availability to tweak those benefits for the employees like you have here with the copays and the office visit copays. So it's a $1,000 deductible. It's 80% to $2,000. So instead of $2,500, the employee would have $3,000 out of pocket. Instead of a $25 office visit copay, they'd have a $35. For a specialist, instead of a $50, they would have a $70. And their prescriptions would be, instead of a $10 for generic, they'd have a $15. Instead of a $35, they'd have a $40. Instead of a $60, they'd have $70. So there's your cookie cutter plan with United Healthcare. Based on those rates with the same count, you're at 5.03% above projected.
Rather than the 0.7.
So, and then the other carrier that we looked at as far as with the 12-1 date, pretty close to the same benefits. Your prescription copays are a little bit higher, but you're looking at 13.44% above what we projected. So that's going out and just saying, okay, we're just going to, it's going to just be all throwaway money. We're going to purchase this plan. There's no, like I said, they're cookie cutter plans, and you do not have that flexibility to design those benefits for your employee. Any questions?
And I guess we should find out if the commissioners have decided to do anything different with the design of the plan too, when when they start, because if we tweak it one way or the other, we can literally affect some of the numbers too.
Correct. And this is staying with the same, as Felicia said, this is staying with the same benefits for the employees, but we can definitely come in, and if we want to change any of those increased co-pays, I mean, if we want to do any changes on those employee benefits, we can do so, which would affect the bottom line.
So if you decide that you want to, instead of $1,000 out of pocket, you would go $1,500, keep the 15 that they would be up to the 3,000, which is what Blue Cross is, but that's going to decrease your exposure. So anything you tweak up above changes down here. And you could still have it so that the county pays their premiums, but... good morning, Nicole.
Good morning. Good morning.
You could still do that and still pay for the employee's premiums, but that's up to you. We can change that any way we want to affect this bottom line.
I think the way it's been going, it's been working pretty good, especially since we know the difference between self-funded and self-funded.
Yeah.
That was the big question.
Commissioner Foley.
So,
not like I said, the benefits that you have for the employees here are, and what you pay towards the premium, are excellent benefits from what I see in the industry and where employers are happy to go. This helps control those costs, as you can see, with the actual with reserves is less than 1% where it was projected. The next page, we always send the savings report, just a copy of the savings report. I'll get my page turned.
And right now, what are they running right now, Julie?
The net savings, well, shows on there.
Yeah.
Right, and then over the right-hand side, we show what the reserve bank balance was at the end of August. At the very right-hand column, the very last column.
$254,820 is what you all have saved this county so far this year over what the county was paying for their insurance. So you've saved that $254,000 so far, but you also have this amount in your reserve account. Commissioner Radcliffe had indicated one time at a meeting that he would really like to see the reserves, how it was doing. So Julie added another column in here so that you could see what's in that little reserve.
Yeah.
Okay. And sometimes that amount in some of your reports you've had is really high, but that means your claims have been good. And when it gets down, you know, you have some bad
luck. Like it did in June.
Right. Yeah. You had 2 or 3 months, Commissioner Radcliffe, when I was saying last time that we're bad, and that's why I didn't want you guys taking that bad report of 5 or 6 months, dividing it by 5 or 6 and multiplying by 12, because you can see right here on this report, you're not running bad now.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, the next page, I just run the top benefits by group, kind of we can see where, you know, how many office visits you've had, the lab work, prescription claims, inpatient, outpatient charges. They're based over on the right-hand side, what has been paid by the plan, so it goes in descending order on dollar amount paid. And on the paid by plan at the very right-hand side, it shows you a total. These do include the dental. So these charges here are medical and dental combined.
So that's everything, your whole plan, medical and dental.
The next report is just the top providers. We always make sure as far as in-network, out-of-network, if there's someone that we need to get a hold of that isn't in-network, that we need to get out-of-network, which the network here has been working very well. I do, again, I've pointed out in the reports before, number 3 is Freedom Claims Management for $4,173.28. If you look over on specialty medications, we work with one employee at the very beginning to get everything done and turned in with United Healthcare so they can continue to get their specialty medications without any delay.
So that's not many that Freedom Claims has. They're using, they're just a clearinghouse for these specialty drugs so that your employee doesn't get hit with that amount coming out of their pocket. They eventually get taken care of. So. And these are your top providers. And I was glad to see that the top provider is your local hospital as far as that, because that means people aren't going. They're using providers here. You have providers that, I mean, there is a couple like Hayes Medical, but there was only 2 claims. So that I was pleased to see that a lot of them are being used locally.
And then the next page, I just, after that report, I just put in a copy of what your current benefits are for your employees with the deductible, the co-insurance, what we went through earlier, and the office visit co-pays and the prescription co-pays. Again, those, as Alicia pointed out earlier on the spreadsheet with the numbers, we can change, you know, tweak those benefits that would reduce the end of the bottom line. But I feel like the plan that you have established for the employees is working very well. And then the next one is the dental benefits. And again, your dental benefits with the maximum calendar year benefit of $2,000, where it covers 100% on your preventive, 80% on your basic, and 80% on your major, is again a good plan. Most plans out there either have $1,000 or a $1,500 maximum.
So can you make a statement at this time on the dental? What you would project the cost would be starting January 1st, 2017?
That's the next report. Of course, the dental, and with the benefits, how we have it set up at the top right-hand corner. Now, we have not increased your dental rates since we've taken this over from corporate plan. So looking at the top right-hand corner, we showed single was $15.99, which is very low. Families at $59.71, employee dependents at $36.69, and employee spouses at $39.56. Through August, and actually, nope, this was a 2015. That was the full year. I wanted to show you the full year. Go to the next page, because that'll be what your current rates are through August. I wanted to show 2 years or a year, a full year that we had the first year on the dental. So again, we've kept those rates at the top right-hand corner where they are. Your actual dental claims are on the lower left-hand corner. So your single, your dental actual cost are running $23.46 for a single, $87.62 for a family, $53.84 for employee and children, and $58.05 for employee and spouse. I can tell you by going out to, like, with your Delta Dentals, your Guardians, whatever, on a dental plan out there, for the plan design that you have, the $23.46, what your actual costs are for the dental, you'd be paying around $45 per single. You'd be paying about $130 to $150 for a family rate, yeah, which you're actually running $87.62. Uh-huh. So these are your actual cost through for this year. They are up from last year. If you look on the report before, your dental claims are up, which is a good thing, though, on your preventive, because you want people to do that preventive. You want to catch things early, and your mouth, your teeth do tell you things about your health. So you do want to encourage the preventive. So having your plan set up with 100% on the preventive is very good, the way that you have your plan set up. But this is where your actual costs are running. The where we have them currently set, I do see that we need to either start funding more for the claims. You pay 100% of the premium anyway. So again, if you pay that premium to a Delta Dental or a Guardian, it would be all throwaway money. There would be nothing in there.
Did you have a question, Commissioner Radcliffe?
We've increased the number of employees this year, so that's part of the cause effect for this increase here. Mm-hmm. With more employees, you're going to have more usage.
Correct.
You are correct. Mm-hmm.
The inflation factor is probably 3% or under.
Mm-hmm. And that is a really good point that Commissioner Radcliffe brought up, because if you go back to the first sheet, that and Nicole wasn't here, but if you go back to the first sheet, that's why it was very important for us when we were comparing United Healthcare and, well, I guess it's the second sheet, I'm sorry, the second sheet where we came in with within 0.7% of projected. Mm-hmm. And you look at the Blue Cross is 13.44 over what you're paying. I understand that's a big spread, but what Commissioner Radcliffe said about the number of employees, that's why we were very careful to make sure we were comparing apples to apples, and they have this number of employees and we have the same number, yeah, so that we weren't saying, oh, well, but they've got three more employees than us. We were very careful on all that to make sure that we were comparing apples to apples. So that is a good point.
Questions on the reporting numbers?
No, I think you guys did it. Gentlemen, thank you.
And thank you for adding that column on the reserve account. It's really helpful.
Yeah, yeah.
That
it,
was
it really does.
Commissioner Radcliffe, yeah, wanted that, yes.
Disclose that number.
Yeah, it's what?
It's 20,000.
$20,505 in reserve. $254,820 that has been in savings, $254,000, $20,000 plus in reserves. Your book, huh? When were you looking to decide, as your commissioners, what you were going to do for next year? What is the next step from here?
We didn't get any other bids from anybody else.
Well, you have bids from every you see.
Well, yeah, but you know what I mean.
No one physically.
Yeah, but we have the information.
It looks like the plan we're on.
I think it's the best plan we can get for the county, for the employees.
Other people enough time for the bid.
Yeah,
we have.
Pardon?
I said, if we give the other people enough time for their bid. What did we give them?
It's not broke, don't
think. A month.
A little over a month.
Mm-hmm. You gave over
that's
a month.
That's long enough, isn't it?
Yeah. So, my advice would be to keep it as it is.
Yeah, I'm fine.
Is that, I mean, that's an official that we can go ahead now and put pressure on the underwriter.
Yeah.
Make sure we get the 2 points less rather than.
Yeah.
I want to put pressure on
go
that.
Go ahead and make
yes.
a motion.
Okay, I'll make a motion that we retain the United Healthcare employee.
We with free.
Well, I think you want to do two things. One, make sure who the actual agent is.
Okay.
And then authorize the agent to go forward with the current insurance plan that we have.
The motion is that we retain Julie as our agent.
Well, it's really easy. Commissioner Poling knows that. He's been around me for 3 years. He knows that.
And we retain United Healthcare as the company for health insurance.
Right. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed, same side. Okay. Thank you for all your work.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Real good.
And
real
you
good
may
documentation.
Read that article about I thought about you.
Nicole.
I
think I wish, well,
yeah, anyway.
Long time
ago. Yeah,
do you have an extra one for Nicole?
Oh, no. Yes.
No.
I'm sorry, no. I just did that for Commissioner Gardner.
No. Are you trying to say that I was right all along?
Yes, ma'am, he is.
Take your notch when you get them.
I'm never going to admit it, but that's your consolation.
And at every meeting, I want you to bring that so that we can always discuss it at every single meeting.
Wonderful. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Commissioner Gardner.
Thank you.
Good seeing you, too.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, Commissioner.
Good to see you.
Commissioner Pauling.
Thank you.
Extra work, people don't know
you
did.
Thank you. This will help, too, on employee meetings and...
Let's have a brief recess.
Okay.
Good seeing you.
Yeah.
Commissioner Ratcliffe, thank you very much.
Yeah.
So nice to see you.
Hi, Deb.
Hey.
How are you?
Nice to see you, Brian. Hey. My pleasure. Yeah. Miss Julie.
Like Miss Julie.
My daughter,
I mean, I can conceive it conceptually.
But for
people who don't work a lot with finance, it's difficult.
You know, the last time we got one that's reported,
I was
showing
it to
the attorney.
It's
like,
I gave him some of my.
Well, also, he was just my friend.
I'm sitting here, I'm
reflecting. But I gave him some of my uncle Lawrence's ties. They're beautiful, silk, and everything. And I said, Brian, try to be on. Show them where they came from.
But this report is so helpful.
It's like, in a way, this ties into the Austin Peters. Everything that they did, they all did.
Miss Alicia, you have a good weekend. Safe trip back to Smith. You know, I'm going to show you this.
This problem has been resolved, if I understand.
I'm taking care of all this.
Raw sewage.
Can I read everything about the book? I know everything. I don't even live here. And I know the book.
I know. The first thing I do is I take a paper and try to find the
commissioner's report. And that's my very first thing.
And
not just here. They want to be
too small.
Too small.
Sure, I know. It's all demographic.
I'm so glad to see you.
It is nice to see you again.
Yeah.
And
we're almost twins today.
Yeah. Both of you girls got the